So it's 2024, or whatever year it is that you're watching this video, and all your friends have been asking you, you have to play Final Fantasy XIV. It is the best MMO multiplayer massive whatever experience. Well, I'm a new player that just finished A Realm Reborn, and let me tell you, this is what you're in store for. Not the best story ever written. Welcome back, Classy Crew, to the fifth journal in my Final Fantasy XIV journey as I really pretty much just aimed to play this game till the end of A Realm Reborn to see what I thought. And I just finished 2.0, which is pretty much the end of the story with the Empire. I understand that there's more patches, raids, a lot of content I haven't touched, but I wanted to share an update with all of you in terms of what was it like to play this game in 2024, almost 10 years after it released. But I just want to share with you that, well, here's my very brief review of the game. It is a lot shallower than I was expecting from a narrative perspective. Now, I went into this with very low expectations. MMOs are kind of limited in terms of mechanics of what a game can offer. It's not a genre I play much of. I do love Final Fantasy, so I've kind of have an expectation of quality whenever something has the Final Fantasy name. And I have to say, I was expecting a little bit more, even though my expectations were low. I was surprised the game ended as soon as it did, at least for the 2.0 part of the game. And I have to say, the ending of it was actually really good, very powerful, and it actually made me appreciate how difficult an MMO can actually be as a single player. So I've always seen the difficulty of MMOs being the coordination between team members when you're doing raids, dungeons, all of that. But the end of Final Fantasy XIV's 2.0 content puts you not just with team-based combat, you have to solo certain bosses with really demanding mechanics, which I was totally not expecting for MMOs. So if you're watching this saying, is it worth me getting into Final Fantasy XIV? Where I am today, I cannot recommend that investment of your time, because from what I'm told, the game starts getting better after the point where I'm at today. So where I'm at today, which is roughly 40 hours into the game, it's a nice little side game to enjoy yourself in with a pretty powerful ending to the story. But if you're gonna stop there, it's just not worth picking up, in my opinion. Now, my opinion is probably going to change significantly as I get into the post 2.0 content, which I'm told is when the story picks up. I also have to keep in mind, this game was pretty much rushed out in order to save the 1.0 version of the game, which is no longer available. So I understand everything that this game, its development cycle, what it was faced with, and also recognizing it's an old game. So I'm not bashing it, but I think I'm giving it the valid criticism it deserves, while still appreciating the surprises it delivered. So with all of that in mind, we're gonna dive into an update as to where I left off last time. I was about to go storm, what was it called? The Mordana, which is an Imperial base. That is where they were keeping Minfilia, which is one of the scions of the Seventh Dawn. And basically that's what I needed to do. I needed to save her. And what I've learned is this pretty much is the cataclysm for taking on the Empire head on, which is what surprised me. I wasn't expecting for the game's story to escalate so quickly, but I'm happy that it did, because this has been some of the best content Final Fantasy XIV has handed so far. So last time we heard word that Biggs and Wedge had escaped captivity in Corathus, and then we had to go save them, so I had a little bit of quest to do that. Then we relocated to Mordana. You know what? I think I said it wrong. Mordana is the Alliance place. The bad place that we're invading is Castrum Country, which is the Imperial city where Minfilia is, or Imperial base where Minfilia is being held. So from Mordana, we're doing all these scouting missions, learning how to do an Imperial salute, learning how to dress like an and then also stealing their mech and putting a heart in it so that it becomes our very own loving Maggie mech. I think they called it Maggie. And this mech becomes quite significant in just a few hours from this point. So going into Castrum, once you do all your preparation, you pretty much storm Castrum Sentry to save Minfilia. And it's a pretty light dungeon. I have to say, what I did enjoy and didn't expect is the fact that there's these minions and mechs that come in and they're invulnerable, and you're like, oh, what do I have to do? And you actually have to like go around. Actually, this is not a dungeon because I think I do this all solo, but you have to basically go around and find these shield generators, which are keeping these mechs invulnerable. You got to shut those down so you can attack them. So very cool mechanic there that caught me by surprise. And then we get huge plot twists. Did not see this coming, but we've learned the whole time that the hooded figure lost Brea was actually Thancred, which I did not see at all. Like, I was not even aware when the Dawns or the Scions of the Seven Dawn all got wiped out. I'm like, oh, Thancred probably just got captured with the rest of them, and he's not noteworthy because there's a bunch of other Scions that don't get a lot of screen time. So I figured, Thancred of all people, why are you you know, the masked figure. So from what I understand, the masked figure, Thancred himself is not bad. He's just being possessed by a bad force. So he's basically a vessel, which kind of takes a bit of the sting away. He wasn't actually bad the whole time. He just fell with some bad people and now has been corrupted. But good job, Final Fantasy. Was not expecting that plot twist, and I love being surprised like that. And the Empire is now in full force to take over the world with their newfound Ultima weapon that is fully armed and operational. So I like this part because we get to see the heads of the cities all like go, oh, what do? We should just maybe Imperial rule is not that bad. And they just kind of reflect and they're starting to like give in until I show up and I'm like, no, we're gonna fight. We're not gonna let them bully us around. What are we gonna do after that? And they're all like, oh, ha ha, in the most cringiest like laughing scene I have seen. Oh, so God, the English dub for this was really, really bad. Anyways, so I basically stir them to fight. We come up with this awesome like four-phase plan to take on the Empire, which I really enjoyed the strategic nature of it and how they actually described it with a map. Like, I was really getting into the story at this point. And then the first phase of the fight is I have to go and fight Redudin Sas Arvina, which is like the big bulky Imperial commander dude. And this fight was my first wall in Final Fantasy XIV. I finished the stream on this fight, and it is so endgame Final Fantasy trope in the sense that it never ends. So we get phase one, and I'm like, okay, I gotta navigate this. It's one-on-one too, so there's a lot of like attacks being launched. I'm just moving around, also trying to cycle through all of my abilities. And then at the end of phase one, he's like, oh, now I'm gonna give it my all. And he just starts like blasting you, and it's at a point where you either have to kill him or he's gonna kill you, because he just doesn't stop blasting these like powerful blasts. Then he goes down. Then phase two, we get minions coming out of everywhere, and he's like unleashing attacks on you while you're dealing with all the minions. And then it's like, oh, phase three, I'm totally not down. Now I'm even more powerful than before. I'm like, oh my God, let's go. And it's even more intense, and I gotta move around. And this is the moment I realized MMOs can be difficult. Some people could say, oh, it's just clicking and pushing the buttons and waiting, and then you just like move around. Yes, but when you drive the intensity of all that up, so at this point you are constantly required to move because the whole floor is lava. And then I'm still not familiar enough with my button rotations that I actually have to look. Like, it's not a matter of not looking. So I have to constantly be looking at my menus of what's on cooldown, what can I push now, while still also looking at the map and the positioning. So like that management of resources and attention is actually quite tough, and it feels intense, and it's not a feeling I was expecting from an MMO. So that was surprising. And then you finally beat him, you go to cutscene, he's on the ground, and you're like walking away. Never would I have thought we would have went from battle to cutscene to another phase, but here we go, phase four. And this is a little bit bullshit. He pulls you in, anchors you to the ground, and now he's just wailing on you, so you can't get out of any of his attacks. And I learned that this is pretty much a DPS race. You just have to kill him before he kills you. And I, like, the first round, I was like, do I really have to do this? This seems hard. Then I died. I was like, oh, maybe I was just supposed to die. Like, you know, in old RPGs, sometimes there are fights you just can't win. I really thought that was the case here. And then it goes game over screen. I was like, what? I'm supposed to actually win this? So I go back and I'm like, oh my God, okay, how am I gonna do this? So I read all my tooltips. I add high potions to my menu. And so I go back in again, a lot more prepared, which is great. This is what walls do to me. And I assume what they do to everyone. And so I go in and, you know, phase one, two, three, cause you gotta restart from the beginning. And then I'm just like going in max. I'm like, all right, first get my dots up. Then I get all these things. My triple attack, let's use my strongest ability. So it hits three times. And I'm just like, boom, 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 DPS. And our health bars are like depleting at the same rate. I was like, oh my goodness, this is not. And then like the screen changes, and I thought, I'm like, oh, I died. I had 49 HP left the moment he died. He did an attack that did like 200-300 HP on me. And through sheer luck, I actually won that fight. So then I checked after the whole cutscene and everything. So I defeated the first Imperial commander. People are like, what's your equipment like? It shouldn't be like that hard at this point. So I pull up my weapon, and I learned I had like a level 30 bow still equipped. So I never grinded out good gear. I was still like on this garbage stuff. So that made me actually more proud that I actually defeated that fight with an under I don't know, underskilled bow or weapon or armor. It really goes along with kind of my journey through Monster Hunter, where I'm always underprepared and somehow make it through. And that makes me feel good. That's how I like to play my games. So yeah, I got through that, and then the game really like opened up to the next phases. There was a few other things I did before jumping into the final segment of the game, which is dungeon after dungeon after dungeon, which I really love the momentum of how they handled the end game. So I did go off and do another optional dungeon that I just missed, that was like a level 38 one called Cutter's Cry. In there, there's a chimera that you fight. There was nothing really notable other than I don't think I understood the mechanic because I kept getting hit by the chimera mechanic. So not much I can say there. I also took the time to go out and level up my bard to level 50. So I got all of the abilities for endgame. I also got the best drip, the official drip of the archers. I got the missing chest piece, which kind of makes everything else work a little better, but I'm still not a fan of these yoga pants. The hat is still though pretty good. So now I've got all of my abilities. I look a little bit better. I also got a level 50 bow from Fire Lord Vaughn at this point, one of the community members. So I was ready to now go into the dungeons, and we had pretty much rotating groups to go through the dungeons. So at the end, you go into Castrum Meridianum, pretty much the outside of the Imperial like fortress, the main one that has Ultima weapon. And in there, the only notable thing I have to mention is Livia Sas Junius, which was not expecting to just be knocking out all the main commanders. That's why I'm like, oh wow, we're really speeding through the story here. So at the end, we learn that she's pretty much just a simp for Gaius. I pronounced it wrong last time. Gaius is the right way. And she kind of fell a lot easier than I was expecting, considering like her reputation, how they built her up in the story. And then right after that dungeon, it's like, let's go, more dungeon. Let's go into the inner dungeon, which is the Praetorium. And there was a lot of good stuff in here, including the fight with Nero. I kind of like his hammer and his armor. Also learn more about his backstory and how it relates to Cid, and how he's been like pretty much has an inferiority complex to Cid. So that was interesting. Did not kill him, just beat him up a bit. So he's going to come back and play a part, I think. Then we have a whole segment with like the mechs, which is pretty cool because you get to like actually use the mech to just blast things and just like make your way. So I really like that they added that mechanic. All this leads to the longest monologue on an elevator I've ever seen with Gaius. We're on an elevator and he's just monologuing away about kind of the rule of power and what things are. Gaius is a very interesting villain. I really like the way that they wrote him. He's a man of vision. You got to give him that. Even though his vision is a little, you know, little negative for the world, at least the guy knows what he wants and he's very, very clear about it. So we get to the bottom of the elevator. We fight Gaius. He goes into gold form Gaius, which for some reason in Japan, going gold form is even more intense. Here, I learned a new mechanic in the fight, which we call the friendship mechanic. So there's like these arrows pointing at you, and basically everybody has to run in together. And it took me a few times to get it because nobody tells me these mechanics. They let me figure it out myself, which I like. So that's a cool mechanic. There's also another one where these like arrows pushing out. So that one I figured out quick. I'm like, I'm assuming this thing's going to blast me away. So when you see that, you have to run towards the center. So you limit how much you get blasted away. So these are like mechanics I've never seen in MMOs before. Again, my experience with MMOs has been limited, but really enjoying how much depth they are able to put into MMO combat. It's just not something I thought that was possible. All of that ends, and then right away it's like, okay, now it's time for your trial. You're gonna go against the Ultima weapon. And I'm just like, oh my goodness, it's just more, it's like a freaking 12 layer cake of dungeon and bosses. So we go Ultima weapon, and then this is a pretty fun fight. Oh, I forgot to mention the most important part of all of these fights, the best song. So Answers has been one of my favorite songs on the soundtrack so far. But now Steel, I think it's called Steel Resolve. I wrote it somewhere, not here though, which plays for each commander. This song just pumps me up and it just makes me feel so like heroic. And again, added to favorite playlist. Okay. Where was I? Ultima weapon. Yeah, so now I'm playing, fighting Ultima weapon, and we're like pulling all of the, what do you call them? Icons away from him. So we get Titan out, we fight Titan, then we get the Garuda out, and then we get Ifrit out. And you know, this feels like I'm progressing. I'm like, I'm weakening Ultima weapon. And then we beat him down, and everyone, guys, is like, no, you're breaking my weapon. How is it possible? And then La Brea shows up. He's like, ah, fools, the real reason of this is to cast Ultima magic. I was like, oh, there's another Final Fantasy trope. And so Ultima happens. Guys is mad because he's like, no, it wasn't supposed to end this way. I didn't want to do this much damage or something. I don't know. I thought we were going to win over guys at this point. Like, he seems like a guy who could be turned to be like a reluctant ally against a greater evil. So now Ultima weapon again, we fight, we beat it. The whole time the crystal goddess is on our side, shielding us from these like intense blasts, and she's getting weak. And then we go into the La Brea fight one-on-one, which is again another intense fight. I didn't feel it was as hard as Ritaten, but intense. Like, I'm just focused and like not bun mashing, but doing my coordination and just feeling the adrenaline, because this game is just like so intense. And then we beat him, and then we get into this like awesome like finale. We're with the light crystal. All our friends come together. We got the power of friendship. We blast La Brea away and get back Thancred. I think we got back Thancred, if I remember. And pretty much we go straight into credits with like a very short end scene, some monologuing. Everyone's like, aha, we're all good. Credit, playing answers. It's all good times. And then boom, we hear the Bahamut, which honestly, I forgot to mention this. I thought for sure Bahamut was the final boss of this game of 2.0. And I say it in all my journals. I'm trying to like put together the plot threads. I thought we were all going to Bahamut, but it sounds like Bahamut is a post 2.0 patch, and this is what we're being set up with. So that threw me for another twist too. Like, I looked way too much into the story, unless it all unravels in post 2.0. But yeah, this is why I was a little like, oh, this is not as deep as I was expecting for the 2.0 story. And it's just like, okay, I'm on board. What's gonna happen next? And so everything ends. We're back at the Waking Sands, I think, the base of the Scions. And the community is telling me in chat, they're like, come outside, come outside. I was like, all right, what's going on outside? So I come out to see a wall of mechs. I was shocked at just how many people had come together all in their mechs, and I walk out and everyone's like celebrating because I finished the 2.0 endgame. And then I've also unlocked the ability to fly with my mounts, and I got my own mech too, so I got to equip my mech. And then we all took to the sky and we're just flying everywhere. It looked like a bunch of bees everywhere, but like, those are the special moments that you get out of MMOs that you just cannot get out of a single player game. And it felt so special. Like, I always see maybe 3, 4, 5 people from my community that are either hovering in the background doing stuff. So to step out and see like 20, 30 mechs that were all on board, I'm like, I was shocked that there were so many people like this. And I get not everybody there was part of the community. There was a lot of people there that were just, I think, jumping on board, seeing that there was like something happening. But it was such a cool moment. And then, yeah, so I messed around with that. And then just before logging off that night, I went back to Ulda, and there was a band playing some music, like some pop music. And I was like, I recognize that music. And I just sat there with some people listening on stream, like the music that was being played by the crystal, by these performers, like these actual human performers that were just playing in the game. And all of that was just so cool. Like, I went to bed that night with like my heart full. It was so fulfilling. I got a good ending to a story. I got like this amazing community moment. And you know, that is the reason that I think these games are worth it, when you really get hooked into a community. I'm lucky because I make content online and I have a community. But even if you don't, I really do believe that when you start these games, you can find one, because the people that play this recognize that's the special part of the game. And they're constantly looking to enrich other people's experience. At least that's what I'm seeing. Even when I wasn't doing content, like when I was playing old MMOs, it was the same thing. People are usually there to help you, and are usually there to ensure that you're having a good time, because ultimately it's this fictional world that we're all having a good time in. So thank you, community, for making my 2.0 ending fun and memorable. And now I really look forward to seeing what's coming up next. And in fact, up to this point, I've been saying I'm on vacation playing Final Fantasy XIV. I've now played it over a month, and I think it's time that we commit a little bit more and bring out the pledge bottle. So if you're new here, I always enjoy doing pledges when I'm playing games. I always like to make them a little spicy. Upon the bottle of pledge, I pledge to play and complete Heaven's Word. The spicy part is there's a time limit. I have to do this by June 30th, 2024. The consequence, if I do not do it, is the next game I'm playing is Monster Hunter Generations Ultimate. if I cannot complete Heaven's Word by June 30th, 2024, the community, all of you, get to decide the condition of my hunts for all of low rank, meaning you choose which weapon I have to play with. And so upon the pledge bottle, I pledge it. And I will see you on the next Journal of Final Fantasy 14. We now have 2.5 months to get through post-ARR and Heaven's Word, or else Monster Hunter Generations U is going to suck in the beginning. I'll see you next time, and until then, keep it classy.